Macmillan Audio presents. Swan Dive. The Making of a Rogue Ballerina. By Georgina Pazcoguin. Read for you by the author. This book is lovingly dedicated to artists, both distinguished and unrecognized, and to the blessed unrest. Author's note. Before we embark on this journey together, there are a couple of things you need to know. I've changed the names of some people, and okay, also some dogs throughout the book. And while my brain and body have memorized countless ballets, I wouldn't say that I can recall each word of every conversation I've had or overheard with the same level of precision. Listen on, knowing I've recaptured dialogue and scenarios to the extent my memory allows. In the audio that follows, I'll be sharing my experience as a dancer at New York City Ballet with you. While much of it is exciting, moving, hilarious slash ridiculous, there is a darkness too. You'll see that I'm not going to hold back when it comes to discussing my experiences, notably with several people who have at times been negative forces in my life. I'd like to say that while I share a deep love and passion for ballet with many, we've all been impacted by intense scrutiny and pressure that have been passed down through generations like dysfunction within a family. We've grown up in a flawed world that celebrates great personal sacrifice, as well as an inherent bias about what a ballerina looks like. But where my commonalities with the cast I'll soon introduce end is that I am a mixed-race woman who has succeeded despite this outdated ideal. How these individuals at NYCB view the ballet world is different from mine, largely for this reason. Their experiences as dancers and now administrators do not and cannot match mine. Swan Dive, a memoir in four parts and introduction. Based on the life of New York City ballerina Georgina Pazcoguin. You've never been to City Ballet? Or any ballet? No problem. I've got you. And even if you do occasionally drop your backside into the plush red velvet seats at the David H. Koch Theater at Lincoln Center, there are a few things you may not know. Brace yourselves. Once upon a time, in 1948, to be precise, a former dancer slash genius choreographer from St. Petersburg, Russia, named George Balanchine, and his partner, Lincoln Kirstein, founded a ballet company. They called it the New York City Ballet, NYCB. Please don't be confused and think I dance with American Ballet Theater, ABT. Another genius choreographer named Jerome Robbins, West Side Story or Fiddler on the Roof, anyone? Was also a founding choreographer of New York City Ballet. Balanchine created his very own training style, which is taught at the ultra-prestigious School of American Ballet, SAB, founded with the same cohort in 1934. But first a school was Balanchine's edict, and now we know why. He had big, big plans for ballet in America. SAB is the first stop on the wild train ride that is becoming a professional dancer with New York City Ballet. City Ballet has also produced and been the home to some of the most iconic American dancers ever. Maria Talchief and Tanaquil Leclerc, both of them were married to Balanchine at one point, by the way, Suzanne Farrell, and of course, the one dancer just about everyone has heard of, Mikhail Baryshnikov. Act 1, 1989 to 2000. A rogue ballerina is born. Ballet lessons, a typical childhood rite of passage, unexpectedly proved to be an actual career choice. Most people find their purpose after college. I found mine at the age of 4. Act 2, 2001 to 2003. Behold the unique growing pains of a working child turned young professional, turned actual adult, turned legal drinker in the city of instant gratification. Act 3, 2003 to 2016. If you've ever seen The Nutcracker, whether your six-year-old niece was playing an angel or you got all Christmassy and posed with your family in front of the iconic fountain before a Lincoln Center performance, you have Balanchine to thank for that. The Nutcracker was the first big production Balanchine created, spreading ballet-themed Christmas joy all over America. Other favorite Balanchine productions, I mean, if you ask me, include Symphony in Three Movements, Agon, and Serenade. You have my full support to skip the Nutcracker for these glorious works of art. Act 4, 2016 to present. It has been the greatest honor of my life to be part of this company, but recently things have been dicey in the house that Balanchine built. The last few years have been marked by drama, scandal, and a whole lot of heartache. The cast. In the following pages, I share my experience as a ballerina on stage and off stage. The good, the bad, and the totally crazy. As you join me on my ballet-fueled journey, you're going to encounter the following characters. Peter Martins. Former dancer turned artistic director who retired amid an investigation into allegations of sexual harassment and verbal and physical abuse, which he denied. Rosemary Dunleavy, senior repertory director, keeper of all things Balanchine. She has all the steps of every production memorized. Stern matriarch when you're a dancer in the corps. Jean-Pierre Froelich, repertory director. The Larry David of the ballet. Thomas A. Lemansky, director of rehearsal administration, keeper of schedule, giver of insults. Georgina's company. The brothers Angle, Jared and Tyler. Jared, young heartthrob, and Tyler, first dancing partner and childhood friend, both principal dancers at New York City Ballet. Savannah Lowry, former soloist at New York City Ballet, best friend, and if that wasn't enough, now she's becoming a doctor. Miranda Grove, best friend since age 4, beaches buddy, literally and figuratively, a la the movie with Barbara Hershey and Bette Midler. Also a professional ballerina, albeit sadly never in the same company. Introduction. Adrenaline. Adrenaline is a great fucking drug. It was the perfect top-off to the full range of emotions I had clawed my way through during the past 24 hours. I rode the one train downtown to the David H. Koch Theater in silence, believing my next performance as a dancer with the New York City Ballet would also be my last. 2 weeks earlier, Peter and I had a yelling match of epic proportions. It ended with me screaming as I ran down the hallway, easily within earshot of anyone in the dressing rooms and the administrative offices. One of my stagehand buddies came running to my rescue to see what was up and make sure I was okay. Now Peter had requested to meet with me. I was sure I was getting fired. I was burning inside as I walked into the office, bracing myself for whatever unjustifiable abuse I was sure was going to be thrown my way. Fat shaming? Maybe I'd be accused of not being fully committed to the company I had danced with since I was a teenager. I was ready to defend myself this time, and my last words to Peter would be as sharp as daggers. I walked into the office and Peter gestured toward the couch where Rosemary, the ballet mistress, was seated. I had really grown to love her over all these years. Her passion and wisdom brought its own form of comfort, strictly unique to Rosemary. She was more stern stepmom than warm nurturer, but my feelings for her were solid, despite her devotion to the man who continually caused me pain. I was glad she was in the room for this moment, even if just to witness whatever happened next. The couch was absurdly low. Peter had positioned his 6'4" frame in a tall chair right across from me. It felt like he had me exactly where he wanted me, at his feet, prone before his throne, like I was paying homage. I was weighed down by dread, but still picked up on a feeling of calm in the room. This is exactly the kind of fuckery that drove my anxiety through the roof. Peter finally spoke.
Georgina, I don't see us ever agreeing or seeing eye to eye.
His emphasis on the word ever was like a quick but sharp jab to my gut. A clear and painful reminder that he seemed to know exactly which buttons to push, and to remind me that not agreeing with him brought consequences. He continued casually, as if we were roommates who disagreed about who washed the dishes last and weren't talking about the end of my life as a ballerina.
We have differences of opinion.
The sadness rushed at me like a wave. I was 29 years old, and my career was about to be over in a snap. This man, whose mere presence in the rehearsal studio loomed over us like a threatening storm cloud, who could take a dancer down with one sharp look or cutting comment, had the supreme power to cut me loose. And it was going to happen right now. I was struck silent, immobile.
You have danced so strongly over this season. That is undeniable.
Peter took a deep, concerning breath before he said,
I've decided to promote you.
His words did not compute. What did that fucker just say? He repeated it.
Gina, I'm promoting you.
My rage starts to dissipate, and I'm flushed with euphoria. Wait, I'm a soloist? I am a fucking soloist? Part of me was in disbelief. Did this just happen? Tears of gratitude were about to spill. I didn't really care if he saw me cry, but I wasn't going to reward him with a display of emotion. After our last blowout, I promised I'd never let him see me get emotional again. Rosemary stood up and gave me a look of approval. I had earned some mutual respect over the years from this woman, who was a very tough nut to crack. Rosemary's career as a ballet mistress began under Balanchine and continued with Peter. In other words, she's dealt with some shit. It was like a strong woman who had been beaten down, extending a hand to another strong-willed woman who had been freshly killed. Peter was standing now, towering over me, looking expectant. Oh, Jesus, come on. He wants me to hug him? I tried to find the will to push aside the disgust I felt from this weird peace offering to just do it, to hug my boss, my abuser. To be clear, abuse comes in many forms, verbal, mental, and physical. I also want to be clear that my abuser did not hit me. Nothing I say in this book should be interpreted otherwise. The harm he has inflicted on me is psychological, and its effect on me has been devastating. I blurted out, "Thank you, Peter, for this recognition." I stuck my arms out stiffly to the side and went in for a hug, but at the last second, my body betrayed me. It's like, as I got closer to my boss, I was confronted with an imaginary force field. The attempted hug between us became more like a chest bump between two rivals who were reluctantly attempting a truce. I kind of ricocheted off Peter's chest and instantly checked myself from laughing at this mutual fail. Taking in Peter's stiff body language and strained expression of approval, I thought, yeah, for a guy in his 60s, you're still solidly classified in the brawny brute category, especially when standing directly next to my 5'5" frame. It was the best I could manage without cracking up in his face. I had won this battle of wills, and he knew it.
Gina. One more thing.
I stopped cold. Oh, so here comes the X. Was this a cruel joke? I slowly turned toward him.
Your carabas, he continued.
I played the role of the evil fairy in Peter's version of the Sleeping Beauty, the first in a growing number of character roles that allowed me to channel my complicated emotions into wickedness.
She just seems a little too mean.
The irony of his statement was not lost on me. At least he got the message. That's one thing I gotta hand him. Peter is not stupid. For the last 2 weeks, I had been channeling every ounce of anger and angst into my role. Okay, I can tone it down. The conversation was over. I was reeling from the unexpected twist. I walked out of the office, no longer a member of the corps de ballet, but the first Asian-American woman soloist in the history of the company. And I had also just agreed to dial back my rage. I headed up to the dressing room to get ready. I had a show in an hour. Tchaikovsky's score was swelling grandly, sounding like a celebration. In 30 seconds, I'd be performing for the first time as a soloist for the New York City Ballet. I rotated roles in this run of Sleeping Beauty, and by stroke of fate, instead of acting Carabosse, I'd grace the stage tonight dancing the Fairy of Courage. This role was a pleasant departure from my usual rep at City Ballet. I often danced the strong female roles, but this time I was playing a strong female that would require classical ballet technique while wearing a very classical tutu. It was the kind of role I knew I could nail if only given the chance, and finally, my advocacy for myself had come through. Waiting in the wings to go on, Canary Fairy's theme had started. Each tinkling note of her song was like a piece of glass shattering in the ceiling I had been trying to break for years. Now I had my title. I was about to grace that stage as a motherfucking soloist. Canary Fairy hit her last pose and disappeared off into the wings. The orchestra transitioned into Fairy of Courage's vamp. My energy pulsing, my body ready to soar with each bump bump. I flew like I had been released from a cage, the conductor and I sharing one heart. I was completely in sync with the rhythm and energy of the orchestra. The same tenacity and grit that freed me from the fist of my boss transformed into power and technical precision, the ultimate badass ballerina combo. The audience was with me for every point and turn, grand jeté, chaîne, and battue. There were a few parts of this variation that had always been a pain in the ass to execute well. Peter's choreography here was crazy fast, a byproduct of the time-honored tradition of men who choreograph things, never taking into account what it would be like to execute the movements on point. Female ballerinas always rising to the breakneck challenge for fear of saying, "Hey, can we take it down a notch?" Imagine telling Jesus that while it's great he turned water into wine, you'd prefer your water be a Syrah blend, not a Cabernet. You have a solo, lady, shut up and twirl. But today, those struggles didn't exist. I was lit. This was my victory dance. The high-octane 90-second variation was choreographed to impress. It ended with a set of diagonal pique turns and saut de basque. This is the kind of shit that seriously wears a ballerina out, but today I had a turbo boost in the form of vindication. I'm right in it. The momentum I have is insane, but suddenly I realize I'm not headed in the right direction. I'm supposed to dance off into the wing, but I'm not lined up right to do that. Shit. I'm headed toward the proscenium at the edge of the stage. I need to decide in a split second whether I should correct myself by sacrificing the momentum, or do I keep going and hope I find a way to stop? I felt amazing. It was kind of like riding your bike down a big hill as a kid. You're speeding along with abandon, and it's pure freedom, hair flying, stomach dropping, a huge smile plastered on your face as you defy gravity. But then you realize the hill is about to end in the middle of a busy intersection. And you're moving at breakneck speed. Do you hop off? Do you slam on the brakes? Do you just hang on for dear life and hope you'll be spared somehow? I land the saut de basque and decide to hang on. I start the chaîne turns and dance with so much fever that I'm on the Marley clearing, all the way onto the apron where the rehearsal pianist normally sits. If this was a rehearsal, I'd be sitting in her lap right now, after crashing into her piano.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.